Welcome to Nursing Research Lecture. In today's class, we are going to discuss how to estimate your sample size. So once you know what method of sampling you are going to do, you must also know how many number of sample you are going to be recruited in your study. So the process of determining the number of sample to be participated in your study is called sample size estimation, or also it is known as sample size determination. So mostly all the quantitative researchers will focus on only one thing: how many number of participants we need to select, so that with the help of those data which we are collecting from those participants or sample, we can able to achieve the statistical validity of our study or not. So a procedure commonly used by the researcher is called power analysis, and this power analysis technique is used to estimate the size of the sample which we need for our study. So estimating the sample size is very important in quantitative nursing research or in quantitative research. So sampling fundamentals you must know when you want to study about the estimation of sample size. So first concept you know very well: population, also called as universe, that refers to the total of the items or units in any field of inquiry, whereas the population refers to the total of items about which information is desired. So mostly in our nursing we focus on the population. So the population refers to total number of items from which we are going to get the desired information. So what is the meaning of statistics and parameter? So a statistic refers to the characteristic of a sample, whereas the characteristic of a population is referred by parameter. So don't confuse. Statistics means the characteristics of a sample, and parameter means the characteristics of a population. Next one is sampling error. That is the bias or the error that arises as a result of taking sample from the population rather than using the whole population is known as sampling error. Instead of taking the information from the whole population, when we take information from the sample during the time when we commit some error, because of this error the result may be affected. So that is called sampling error. Next concept is confidence interval. Confidence interval is the range of values within which a population parameter is estimated to lie at a specified probability. For example, so in most of the nursing research, at the confidence interval of 95% or 0.05 level of significance, the parameter value is supposed to lie. That is called confidence interval. It is the range of values within which the population parameter is estimated. So within that range, so we can expect the population parameter value will be there. Next one is sampling distribution. Sampling distribution is a statistic obtained through a large number of samples drawn from a specific population. So sampling distribution is a type of statistic which is obtained through a large number of samples drawn from a specific population. So when our population is 50,000, for example, I am taking 15,000 sample. So that is my sample distribution. So how much my sample is distributed? Sampling distribution is a statistic obtained through a number of samples drawn from a specific population. So statistics is a characteristic of a sample. Next one is sample size. This is the subpopulation to be studied in order to make an inference to a reference population. So the sample size is the subpopulation what we study from the samples. For example, the samples may be 500, but in our study, we are taking a portion of that units or elements. For example, assume that I have taken 200 samples. So from that 200 samples, I am going to make the inference of my statistical result, and I am going to generalize to the population. So that number is called sampling size. So next one, what is sample size determination? Sample size determination is the mathematical estimation of the number of subjects or units to be included in a study. Very simply, how much number of samples which we need for doing our study. So that is sample size. It is a process of finding how many number of sample is needed in our study. It is a mathematical process. So next one is why we need to do sample size estimation in our study. There are three reasons for which we are doing the sample size estimation. The first one is the sample size estimation allows for appropriate analysis. To have a good analysis, we need to do proper sample size estimation. Second one is to provide the desired level of accuracy. So our result must be very accurate when we have followed proper sampling technique and proper method of estimating the sample, and when we have that much amount of sample which we included in our study. So a proper result which is very accurate we get by having a good sample size in number. To allow the validity of the significance test, the third purpose of doing sample size estimation is to get the test value which is very valid, very reasonable value, which is acceptable among all. So for that purpose also we are getting the sample size done. For example, we get a result about a particular product. When we get the sample size very small, that result may not be valid. When we go for higher number of sample, the result can be easily generalizable, that is more valid. The next one is, what are the attributes of a good sample? First one is to extrapolate the inference of the sample to the population, that is to generalize. So we are making the result of our study generalized to the population of our study. We need good samples. That sample should be, first, it should be a representation of the population. That is, what sample we have, that must have all the characteristic feature of the population. Second one, the sample size should not be very less. It should be large enough. So when we have good number of sample, we can able to get accurate result. The result findings can be easily generalizable, and sampling errors can be minimized when we have good large number of samples. Next one is, what will happen when our sample size is too large? If our sample size is too large, we get good precise result in the analysis of our statistic. So when our sample size is too large, we get less errors and less bias. Always keep good number of samples. The sample size should be somewhat larger. When we keep large samples, we get accurate results and we get precision in the result, and also we get less errors and less bias. But some disadvantages also there to have a large size sample: waste of money, time and resources. When we have large size sample, we go and collect data, it takes more time, that is waste of our energy also and cost also. and sometimes to keep large size sample, we are not able to affordable by the cost. So it is not cost effective. So what are the goods and disadvantage of having a small size sample? So when we have small size sample, the result is inaccurate and bias may be more, and power of the study comes down, and the study fails to give the meaningful information, and waste of resources on inaccurate study. So when we do a study with small size sample, it is based off putting effort, putting the resources. So that study may be inaccurate study. So this is the pros and concerns about sample size, either large or smaller. So what are the methods of calculating the size of our sample? There are commonly four methods out there to estimate the sample size. First one is use of formula. There are lot of formulas to estimate the sample size. We cannot say this is the only formula which the researcher must adopt in selecting the sample size. The second one is ready-made table like log book. We have the tables. Similarly, sample size estimation tables also available. With that, we can estimate the sample size very easily. Next one is use of nomograms. It is one kind of graph method where we can able to compare the values. The power can be compared with the standard values. And next one is computer softwares are also available nowadays to make the estimating work very easier. Let's see one by one. Use of formulas. There are a lot of formulas are applied in estimating the sample size. For exam point of view, I have selected 2-3 common formulas which we use in estimating the sample size. First, to calculate the proportion. For example, some of the studies like estimating the prevalence, estimating the incidence of certain disease in certain area, use the following formulas. That is the formula for calculating proportions. For example, studies like estimation of prevalence of tuberculosis in Panipat in 2018, or we are estimating the prevalence of extrapyramidal side effect complication among patients with antipsychotic drug. So when we do such research, the formula commonly used is N is equal to 4PQ upon D square. So this is the formula which we are following to find the proportion. So where P is the prevalence of previous studies. So what do you mean by prevalence of previous studies? So similar studies which have been done in the past. So that value we are taking as the P value. In previous studies, what prevalence rate we got, that is the P value of the present study. And Q is equal to 100 minus P. That is the prevalence value is reduced from that 100. 100 is the constant value and D is the allowable error. So how much amount of error we are permitting? Mostly 5% error we are giving. So that is 20% of P. So 20% of in the 100%, 20% means 5. So the value of D is 5. So by using this formula, we are calculating the proportion. For exam point of view, study the formula and write in the exam. Next one is the another formula for calculating the difference in proportion. So the commonly studies like diagnosing the supremacy of CT chest versus X-ray chest in tuberculosis patient. For example, you want to compare two different intervention, which intervention will be best than the other. So second one example is success rate of streptomycin versus kanamycin in cure of MDR, multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. So such studies, we use the formula N is equal to 15.7 multiplied by P multiplied by Q upon P1 minus P2 the whole square. So this is the formula which we are used to calculate difference in proportion. So where P1 and P2 are the proportions of the two groups. So P1 and P2 are the proportions of the two groups, where P is the that is the capital P1, capital P2 are the proportions of the two group. Small p is the average of two groups proportion, that is P1 and P2 divided by 2. That is the small p, proportions of the two groups. Average is the small p. So when we use this formula, we get the sample size required for the studies, like to compare the two interventions, like efficacy of that is streptomycin over kanamycin in multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. In such studies, we want to use this formula. The third type of formula commonly used to identify the differences in mean. The studies like estimation of mean age of diagnosis of tuberculosis in Panipat. So among Panipat people, which age group commonly, the average age of people affected by tuberculosis. So in such studies, we are using the common formula. N is equal to 15.7 into standard deviation 1 multiplied by standard deviation 2 upon d square. So where sigma 1 and sigma 2 are the standard deviation of the two groups, d is the smallest meaningful difference that can be measured, and this one, that is in before and after type of studies, that is standard deviation 1 is equal to standard deviation 2 is equal to standard deviation. So all these values will be basically equal. So that is the assumption here. So this formula is used when we are calculating the differences in mean. Now, what is the ready-made tables? So some of the ready-made tables are commonly available to calculate the sample size. So this ready-made table example I have given here. So it's one of the standardized table, ready-made table to calculate the size of the sample. For example, my population in Panipat, for example, in the area where I'm going to do the study, there are 5,000 people in the village. So I want to select the sample at 95% confidence interval. At the margin level, the margin of error as 2.5%, then I need this much amount of sample, that is 1176. So like this, we have standardized tables. The values are given by comparing the confidence interval percentage. Like confidence interval can be done in 95% also, 99% also, and mostly in nursing we are doing 95% as a standard value. So what is the margin of error, whether you want 5% or 3.5%, 1%? So according to that, we select the sample. This is very easy method for doing random table method. By applying this random table method, we select the sample size. Next one is use of nomogram for sample size calculation. So nomogram is one type of graphical method for calculating the sample size. It was developed by Altman's nomogram. The nomogram looks like this. So this is a standardized graph in which we have the standard differences and we have the power. So how we select the sample? We select the sample based on these two values. For example, at 0.50 as the power, for 0.7, what will be the sample? So this value is drawn to 0. So a straight line is drawn. So which number comes here? That will be the sample size. So again, I'm telling for example, I want to select the sample as the power is 0.80 and my standard difference is 0.8. So I'm going to connect a line, straight line between 0.85 and 0.8. So which value comes in this graph, that will be the sample size. The next one is use of computer software for calculating the sample size. Nowadays, this is done, that technique is also called power analysis. So lot of softwares are available like SPSS, Strata, Power of Precision, EpiInfo, nQuery. So these are the common software names for estimating the size of sample. So the conclusion is sample size determination is very, very important component in every research. The larger sample size gives higher precision and degree of result. When you have small size sample, we could not able to generalize the finding with the population. And when we have more number of samples, we can use various formulas, or we can use the graph method like Altman's nomogram, or also we can use random table standardized sample size table method, and softwares are used to estimate the sample size. So here we come to the end of the sampling unit. Meet you again with a new chapter, data collection and data process. Thank you. Bye bye.